This last Friday, I was. My brother asked me a question because of how the number of people who used to come in Massa to pray. Then he asked me, these people, all of these people are coming for prayer. I said, yes, because this, today is Friday. And he said, do you think that all of them are going to perish? So it was a question. And I said, yes, they are going to perish. And it's not your business, is what I told you. It's not your business to get concerned of that. Because God has planned everything. When God was destroying people on the time of Noah, make sure there were many people who died. But God was not concerned about the number of people. And when he was destroying people of Sodom and Gomorrah, make sure it was a number, a big number of people. And he's the same God, and he's also the same God who said that through Christ, through Jesus Christ, there is salvation. And without him, you will be destroyed. Amen.
Amen.
So I want just to share something, because sometimes we used to put our concern on those kind of things. You can see the number, you can see, you say, all the, let's say, Islamic country, there are a lot of people. And we want just to share it with the time that God give us. The Bible says in the book of Acts, chapter 4, verse 12, that salvation is to be found through him alone. In all the world, there is no one else whom God has given who can save us. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I thank you for this opportunity that we can come close to you, that we can share your word, that we can listen to your word. We are people. You are the one who started and who will also end the service. As we are here, be with us. As I'm going to share this word, give me a good way to explain, and open also us, our hearts, to understand your scripture. Not only to understand and to keep it for ourselves, but to be able also to act it in our life. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
And we are going just to take some of the example of people that they were seeking for eternal life, as we know in salvation. And if we will have time, maybe we can read them, but if we don't have time, maybe we can read them at home because of the time. But I will give all the scriptures. So first of all, we can see the rich man. He was a young man, and God blessed him with a lot of things. So he was not worrying about the things of the world. But his concern was also for eternal life. Because he was living in a good life and he wanted to continue living forever. In the book of Mark, chapter 10, verse 17 to 21, I read, as Jesus was starting on his way again, a man ran up, knelt before him, and asked him, good teacher, what must I do to receive eternal life? Why do you call me good? Jesus asked him, no one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not commit murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not accuse anyone falsely. Do not cheat. Respect your father and your mother. Teacher, the man said, ever since I was young, I have obeyed all these commandments. Jesus looked straight at him with love and said, You need only one thing. Go and sell all you have and give the money to the poor, and you will have riches in heaven. Then come and follow me. Amen.
Amen.
So as you can see here, there was a man, a young man, as the Bible also is describing, he was in a very good age, and he was blessed with all kinds of things. As we know, people used to say, when you have money, you have everything. When you have money, you have the power. But we can understand that this man had the power, but there was one thing that he could not have. It was eternal life. That when he saw Jesus doing all kinds of miracles, he found that Jesus can explain to him how to live forevermore. And he came to Jesus, calling him Master, good Master. And Jesus said, I am not the Master, the good one, only God alone. But what we want just to see about the life of this person and what Jesus also tell him. First of all, Jesus sent him back to the commandments, because Moses came with the commandments that there are things you need to follow so that God will bless you and you will be in peace with God. But as we can see, these things were not enough. They were not guaranteed for his salvation. Because, as we can see here, the man replied that, since I was young, I followed them. But in that context, we can see that there is commandments that you need to obey. But this man, this young man, was obeying that. And God also was with him. God also blessed his life. But it was not enough for him to be saved. It was not enough for him to be saved. Because the law, there is no guarantee for the law. You can follow the law. You can do whatever you do to please, as the Bible is, as the commandment is saying. But salvation is not after the law. That's why Jesus, first of all, he sent him back to the commandment. And if we have to take verse 10 and 20, so 20 and 21, Jesus looked straight at him with love, because he found that he was a man pleasing God. He was a good man with a very good character. And said, you need only one thing. So, it means when you have a contract with somebody, the person needs to fulfill the contract. For example, I'm working in Massa Open Center. So, my presence in Massa is counting money. Why? Because of the agreement we make that I must come from Monday to Friday to be there, to work, to do my duty, and after, on the end of the month, I get my salary. So when we come now to the end of the month, if they are asking me something to do, I will say this is not the agreement, because something is missing. But as there is a covenant, we can understand that everybody need now to follow the covenant. So the question is, why do Jesus say that? He found that the person was good. He was doing everything perfectly.
What?
And he said, you need one thing. And the Bible said that Jesus came not to abolish, to abolish the law, but to fulfill the law. So, the fulfillment of the law is coming from Jesus Christ. And it was the thing that this man was in need. Jesus said, you need the only one thing. Go and sell all you have and give the money to the poor. And you will have riches in heaven. Then come and follow me. Today we can find people also following the scripture. They are giving their money. They are helping people. They are making a good way for charity. And the question is, do they are following Christ? Because the only one thing Jesus said is, to give up, to give the thing to the poor, to sell and to give, to share it, and to come. So once we give and we don't come back to him, that means we are not following what he said. We are not doing it. And the question is, why do Jesus say to him to go and to sell everything he has and to follow him? Because Jesus said in the book of John chapter 14 verse 6 that I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can go to the Father except by me. So he found that this person was ready to come to God. He was ready for the eternal life. But because I am the way, he need to go to sell all the things that he had and to come to follow me because I am the way. You cannot go to the Father except by Jesus Christ. So why is selling these things? Because in heaven, we don't need to carry whatever we have here. We can have a lot of money, we can have a big poverty, but once a person dies, he will not know which place they are going to bury him. So if this man has to gain all the things, Jesus would say, come with your money. And today we are finding most of the Christians, most of the pastors are deceiving people by saying that come to invest in the work of God is good. But first of all, people must follow Jesus Christ. You can find one day I was watching it on the TV. They put, as we collect the offering, the pastor stand up and they say, for the 100 euros. So those who have 100 euros, they make a line, they are come, they are offering, and he's praying for them. 50 euros. So those people are giving, but Jesus said, go and give the money to the poor. And come follow me. So people today, they tell the scripture. Because why? They need money. And the money that they need, they are not going to take it with them. Because once we die, we forget everything. Once we die, we become poor. In Congo, if somebody dies, they call him poor. Like my father who died, we call pauvre papa. That means he cannot do anything, even though he's my father. Why? Because he become weak. Because if you put his body there, it will smell. But a living person, you put him there, he will go and to the toilet to clean himself. On the eternal life, we don't need to carry the things. We don't need anything. That's why Jesus said, go and sell everything you have and come back, follow me, because I am the way, the truth, and the life. You cannot go to the Father. You can do everything you can do, but you need to pass by me to be received. And we can also take another example of one of the Pharisees, Nicodemus. And if you know this passage, Nicodemus was one of the Pharisees, and he studied a lot about the coming of the Messiah. And everything that he had been told since he was young, he found that then to Jesus Christ. And one day he came to Jesus Christ, that we can find it, I think it will be much more better. John 3, verse 1 to 3. There was a Jew's leader named Nicodemus, who belonged to the party of the Pharisees. One night he went to Jesus and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a preacher sent by God. No one could perform the miracles you are doing unless God were with him. Jesus answered, I am telling you the truth. No one can see the kingdom of God without being born again. So Jesus now is describing the way by being born again. That means you need to change. And when we go for the baptism, we are dying with Christ and we are coming back with a new life with him. And if we have to jump to 14, as Moses lifted up the bull's neck on a fold in the desert. In the same way, the Son of Man must be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. And we know the story of Moses. When the snake was biting people, and God telling him to lift one, to make one and to raise it up, so that whenever the snake bites you, you just look. It was very simple. You can be on from the north, you just look. You can be from the south, you just look where it is and you are safe. It was very simple. You don't need to run. You don't need to make something or to give something. You just look. And here also Jesus said that the Son of Man also must be lifted up, so that whoever believes in him will have eternal life. So we can give our money to the poor. We can come and pray. If we don't believe to Jesus Christ, there is no chance for us. There is no way for us. As many as we can be, there is no chance for us. For God loved the world so much that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not die but have eternal life. If we have to see on 36, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever disobeys the Son will not have life, but will remain under God's punishment. So, the scripture is so clear here. We need to believe in Jesus Christ. We need to give our life to him. And God will receive us and he will change our life. If we have to take another example, because there are so many examples about these things, and they are, it's important for our life, about the Egyptian eunuch. I think maybe because of the time, we can read it at home. On Acts 8:25-39. Or maybe if somebody can read us just quick.
So when they had testified and preached the word of the Lord, they returned to Jerusalem, preaching the gospel in many villages of the Samaritans. Now an angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, saying, "Arise and go towards the south along the road which goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is desert." So he arose and went. And behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, the queen of the Ethiopians, who had charge of water treasury and had come to Jerusalem to worship, was returning. And sitting in his chariot, he was reading Isaiah the prophet. Then the Spirit said to Philip, "Go near and overtake his chariot." So Philip ran to him and heard him reading the prophet Isaiah, and said, "Do you understand what you're reading?" And he said, "How can I, unless someone guides me?" And he asked Philip to come and sit with him. The place in the scripture which he read was this: "She was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and the lamb before its shearer is silent." So he opened not his mouth. In his humiliation, his justice was taken away. And who will declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth. So the eunuch answered Philip and said, "I ask you, of whom does the prophet say this? Of himself or of someone?"
A good man, every time there is something in Jerusalem, he must go to adore his God, to give his sacrifices, to offer his sacrifice and to worship God also. And he was also a good man, as you can see, taking from his place to Ethiopia, to Israel. It was, he must take some days. But he was willing to go in because why? He feared God. He was living in a good life. And he was not a poor, he was also one of the in a high position in his country. In his country. But the question is, why do God send Philip for him? Because he was already a good man. He was already obeying God. He was already ready for him. If he died, he will be. People will testify about what he was doing. But God would not leave him like that. Because God has just one way that we need to follow, that we need to enter. And there is just one door that we need to enter, which is Jesus Christ. Immediately as we hear that God, the Spirit of God was with Philip and sent him to the desert just for the salvation of the man. He was not a pagan, he was a man who feared God. But why do God send Philip for him? That is the question. And there is also, there are so many examples. What about Cornelia? In Acts 10, if you read from 1 to 44, you will find all in him about Jesus Christ. Then when I come close, they say, ah, GB, ah. Then I realize that they are talking about that. I say, you, I have nothing to tell you. You know how we were talking when we are working. You are, he's from Ghana, he used to give me a name of a pastor. He used to be a pastor, but now he returned back to the Muslim. Isa Osei, I don't know if some of the people, they know him. And he used to tell me, you, if you meet such people, you will be just quiet. You will not say anything because he knows the Bible very well and he knows Quran very well. Then I was telling him, can you ask yourself a question? Why do these people, because I don't know them. And I hope the thing they tell you is the same thing I told you. That means God has a plan for your life. He's sending people. So whenever we are speaking to people, even though they don't listen to us, but you, your job is just to tell them. By the way that you tell them, our brain can keep more information. It will be on their heart. So that one day, if there is somebody else are telling them, they will remember what you tell them until God will save them. So for me, if you find people, let's say, as what we were debating last time, the game, just tell him that you believe in God. If he does not, you tell him some of the things. You give him some of the examples. You finish your job. I know many of them, they say no. They reject. But there is a day that God will save them. And if they don't believe, they will be punished about what you told them and they receive it. Because people who say they are ignorant, they never hear about Jesus Christ. That is another case, but they need to know about Jesus Christ. And if we have to see, Peter went back to Cornelia. He went to his call. And the Bible is so clear here. Peter began to speak. I now realize that it is true that God treats everyone on the same basis. Those who fear him and do what is right are acceptable to him, no matter what race they belong to. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel. So here we can find that Cornelia, because he said, you know the message God sent to the people of, because we can understand that Cornelia hear about Jesus Christ. But because maybe because of the distance, he could not believe to him. But he hear about that, because the Bible said that, you know the message he sent to the people of Israel, proclaiming the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is the Lord of all. You know of the great event that took place throughout the land of Israel, beginning in Galilee. I think it's that, because in French we say Galilee, and it's written the same thing.
Galilee.
So for me, to understand, Galilee.
Galilee.
Galilee. Galilee. After John preached his message of baptism. 38. You know about Jesus of Nazareth and how God poured out on him the Holy Spirit and power. He went everywhere doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses of everything that he did in the land of Israel and in Jerusalem. When they put him to death by nailing him to a cross, but God raised him from death 3 days later and caused him to appear, not to everyone, but only to the witnesses that God has already chosen, that is, to us who ate and drank with him after he rose up from death. 42. And he commanded us to preach the gospel to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God has appointed just judge of the living and the dead. As we hear here, Jesus commanded us to preach the gospel to the people. So for me, when I read this one, this scripture, I first of all ask myself a question. Because we are the one who believe in Jesus Christ today. That means we are taking the place of Peter today. Because Christ was with Peter, he was with John, Paul, all of them. And Christ is also with us, as we used to sing, we used to shout, we used to proclaim every day. And we are taking now the place of Peter today. And we need to know, because Peter said, and he commanded us to preach the gospel to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God has appointed. Are we doing it? This is the question that God is asking us. If we say that we are Christian, are we doing it? Are we proclaiming the word of God to people? But when we found, we see many people, we say, ah, look at them. There is nothing for them. When they die, finish. Because they are not with Christ. Because the Bible says that you need to believe in Jesus Christ for you to be saved. But when we look at them, we say, ah, no chance for them. Why we need now to tell them? That's why God could not tell the angel to speak to Cornelius about Jesus Christ. Because there were Peter, there were people ready to speak to them. And God is not a God of doing things many, many ways. When he put his things in this way, you need to follow. If you don't follow, you reject. That's why he could not tell the angel to speak about. Maybe the angel would say, Cornelia, you know about Jesus, you know what happened in Jerusalem, because it was the word that Peter was telling him, that you know what happened in Jerusalem, and how they killed him, and how everything passed. The angel could say it, but God did not send the angel for that. He sent Peter for that, because there were people already there. And we who take place, Peter, for this generation, we need to know that Jesus commanded us to preach to the people about the gospel, about the good news, so that through the gospel they will be saved. Why? Because what is the gospel? The gospel is the instrument that God is using to save people who believe. So when there is no gospel, there is no also salvation. But once we take the gospel, God is using us. He will use people. That is the gospel. But are we doing our job? That is a question that God is asking us today. When we saw the Jehovah's Witnesses, we say, look at these people. Always sharing the faith. Always, sometimes you take it in front of him, you just do it. We say, is not true what they are talking about. But I will ask you myself a question. Why those who say they have the tool, they are not using the tool they have? They keep it for themselves. But those who say it's a false teaching, every time they more, you will find them with. One day they come to my place and we discuss more, they never come there. You will find them with their dress well, the suit, the hair, they say small thing, no more. Always going home until you go to Slima, you find them. You go to Mostar, you find them. They pass everywhere.
Why we say that Jesus has the name of Jehovah? So why they had the name of Jehovah? You say that Jesus had the name of Jehovah is the name of Jesus.
Yes.
So why those people name themselves Jehovah?
They call themselves Jehovah, but Jehovah was not the name that was given to us to be saved. Jesus is the name. That's why in Acts, that's why we found out that there is a mistake somewhere. Because if we use the name of Jesus,
and they call themselves Jehovah,
that is a mistake they are making.
But Jehovah is for them.
It's the Father.
Yes. For Jesus.
They are concerned about the Father.
Jehovah. Aren't they the right people to say
the
persuade?
We
know that the name of Jesus is
Maybe we can discuss it later because of the time. But what God wants to ask us the question, are we preaching the gospel to people? That is the question. That is the question. Or are we living in hypocrisy? We call ourselves Christians. We come in the church, we sing, we pray, we do everything. But for me to go and tell people about Jesus Christ, they will discover what I used to do on the city. Or maybe we are not mature. And we found ourselves that we cannot do it because we don't know nothing. But why are we still remaining baby? And pastor need always to teach us, and we all want to grow. These are the questions that God wants to ask to us. Maybe we are not taught about that. Or maybe it's not our business. Because my business is to go to church, to give my offering, to sing, and that's all. But we need to tell them. We need to tell them. Maybe we are selfish. We want to keep. Because we are saved, we don't want heaven, not all people. Maybe we found ourselves with selfishness. I found that at this person, he knows how to speak better than me. If I tell him the gospel, he will pass my place. So I will. People will neglect me and they put me aside, they will consider him alone. Now this person maybe he study a lot. So those who study a lot, when you give them a scripture and you preach to them the gospel, they will understand it much more better and they are ready to do it much more better than you. So better you don't speak to them. So these are the things that keeping us not to spread the gospel of Christ. And we need to know that it is our responsibility to do it. It is our responsibility if we have to call ourselves Christian, if we have to call ourselves children of God. But God made a job for us. He commanded us to preach the gospel to people so that they will be saved. So if we are not doing it, it seems there is a mistake somewhere. Maybe because we are busy with whatever we need. We want to get more from the world. On Wednesday we were sharing and an example came in my mind and we shared it. It was a question. I'm praying and God bless me with a lot of money. All of us here, we have plan, we have projects. So with enough money I will say, let me go to Congo. I will make a fazenda. I don't know if you know fazenda. In Brazil it's a house, a big house inside a very big place, compound, you have everything inside. You can make even a small river, fish and everything. You are living with a better life. I can can do it if I have money. But the question is, I get it. I get the money, I put the money in the bank. I know that I'm going, this, I buy the ticket, and I arrive just at the airport. Jesus, that can. That I need to go with him. So what is the use of that money? Or I go, I build, I engage people to work for me. Most of the people who work there are only family. They don't take the single. They take you as a family, they give you a house. You are just working there with your children, everything. They belong to me. And I finished everything. I say, now I will no more go to Europe. I have a good life. I will just go for shopping, maybe a car and things. Every month, people need to come in my place to buy things. And they go. And the moment I finish that, Jesus Christ came. So what is the use of that thing? Because we are putting our concern about the things that are not important for our salvation. And we neglect what is important, what God is putting our his eyes on. Because God wants to see people preaching. Because the Bible says that in Matthew 24, if I don't make a mistake, that the gospel, the good news of the world must be preached all the world. And if we have to take it, we have 24 hours. 8 hours to work, 8 hours maybe to sleep, maybe the other one to relax, to listen to the music, computer and things, but what even 30 minutes we do for God? In one day, we find that God will bless us and God will please us. Because if we have to condemn those who are doing it, we are also making a very big mistake. Every week you find a job in a startup in your door. But we say we wear the truth, we don't want to use it. And we are living in a very big mistake. In a very big mistake. Just to end, and maybe someone can find us 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 1 to 2. Yes.
6:1-2.
We then, as workers together with him, also plead with you not to receive the grace of God in vain. For he says, in an acceptable time I have heard you, and in the day of salvation I have heard you.
Amen. Amen. So this is the day of salvation. And if we are not using that time, it will be too late for us. And God and Jesus, who is the judge, will ask us, I give you all. You are not getting sick like others. Always you are strong, but the hours, you did not use it. That is the question. May God bless you all.
Amen.
We have a job. Our primary job is to share the word of God. Amen?
Amen.
Let us stand and pray and end this service, but not end our worship of God. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you, Father. We just lift your name this morning, Lord.
Yes.
And we thank you for this time, for this message, for this scripture in our lives, Lord, for the gospel that is in our life, Lord, for the seeds that have been sown today in our life. We pray, Lord, that whatever you have asked of us this morning, we don't just walk out the door and forget it, but we let those seeds grow. We really take it to heart. We spend time with you and we pray about those things, Lord. Because what we hear, if we shut our hearts, if we shut our ears, and we just continue with our daily life, with the priorities of the world, Lord, then it's for nothing. Then we are just meeting for nothing. But Father God, I pray that through your Holy Spirit, our eyes will be opened more. Our ears, our spiritual ears, will hear more. That this message that we hear, Lord, we apply it during the week. I pray for those people that you bring in our lives, Lord, that we will be bold, we will be courageous, we will not judge, but we will share the gospel. Who knows when you will save them, Lord? The Bible says, Lord, that the arm of the Lord is not too short to save.
Yes.
So who are we to judge? So, Father God, we give this week in your hands. And we ask you to bless it, Lord.
Amen.
And to make us good disciples of this message, Lord.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let's hold our hands.